Docile Individuals Conference, Docile Individuals, Privacy, Community, and the State. I'm Luisa Papke, a graduate student here at the Political Science Department and organizer of this conference. I'm very pleased to open this event that will consist in tonight's keynote speech and a full day of panel discussions tomorrow from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. at the Hyman Center, which is close by here. Let me take this moment to warmly thank all the sponsors that made this conference possible, namely Columbia University's Department of Political Science, the Hyman Center for the Humanities, the Center for Critical Contemporary Thought, and the Institute for Comparative Literature and Society. Without their financial and administrative support, we would not have been able to host this event. The topic of this conference is the question whether we are becoming, or may have been all along, docile individuals. Western liberal democracy depends on individuals to be competent and self-directed agents, adequately equipped to be principals of their political representatives, among other things. Liberal and democratic theory consequently continue to discuss the nature and conditions of individual liberty and autonomy, thus moral independence, individual self-reliance, and the defense of individual liberty against tendencies of conformity and docility are much debated in political discourse as well as theoretical reflection. This very liberty, however, seems increasingly under threat as a consequence of a number of political and societal changes in mass democracy and, crucially, technological advances. The state's growing capacity to monitor our citizens seems to date boundless. Private corporations hasten the screening of individual behavior and preferences for their own often commercial purposes. The role of the internet is still ambiguous in this context with respect to its effect on meaningful civic engagement. Despite the increasingly threatened private sphere, however, or maybe because of it, the reality of democratic politics today seems one of waning civil and political participation. Citizens thus risk becoming mere docile figures, transparent in their pursuits and desires, and well-managed within prescribed limits of policy and market. The question whether we should think of individuals in the way that liberal democratic theory does has raised, of course, a fair amount of criticism, with 20th century thinkers such as prominently Michel Foucault or Gilles Deleuze questioning the ideal of the individual conceived in this way and the validity of individualism. This conference will reflect this ongoing debate and scrutinize it under the light of new mechanisms of domination brought forth and made possible by advances in notably surveillance technology. Given the new problems and ongoing theoretical challenges to liberal individualism, therefore, it is important and to critically engage with the question of the proper relation between individual, society, market, and state in order to understand the novel set of problems that democratic societies face today. The conference is an interdisciplinary event that brings together renowned scholars from different fields of study who among them follow and discuss different methodological approaches and ideas. Bernard Harcourt, Nancy Hirschman, Helen Nissenbaum, Nancy Rosenblum, and Alex Zakaras will address different facets of those issues. It will be exciting to hear their take on these pressing set of issues, and I warmly invite you to also attend tomorrow's proceedings. Tonight, we are honored to have Professor George Kateb deliver the keynote address with a speech on tyranny and the fate of individuality. Professor Kateb, as many of you will know, is the William Nelson Cromwell Professor of Politics Emeritus at Princeton. He's the author of a number of influential scholarly works that have, I would wager, influenced the thinking of most participants of this conference, and many of you here in the audience tonight. His elaboration and defense of the concept of democratic individuality and his analysis of the ethical dimensions of the individual, in a constitutional democracy and the nature and dangers of individual conformity and docility are crucial reading for anyone interested in understanding democratic life. Among his books and essays, I would like to mention, as especially relevant for the purposes of this conference, of course, his collection of essays, The Inner Ocean, Individualism and the Democratic Culture, and the book Emerson and Self-Reliance in the 1990s, in which he extrapolated and explored the concept of democratic individuality in the thought and writings of Ralph Waldo Emerson, Henry David Thoreau, and Walt Whitman, a concept that has undergirded much of his work since. His analysis of constitutional democracy and the culture that it brings forth as one that can give birth and sustain a particular kind of individuality, democratic individuality, is crucially insightful, not only as a means to understand our intellectual tradition better, but also as a constant concept with which to critically analyze the realities of democratic society and politics today. His work continues to highlight and unveil also the problems within liberal democratic practices. For instance, in his book, Patriotism and Other Mistakes, Professor Kateb interrogates both how we conceive of the foundational values ruling our res publica and how they are challenged by the newly arising political questions and practices. In his latest work, Human Dignity, in 2012, he returns to probing one of, if not the most fundamental values undergirding the ideal of liberal democracy. I'm therefore thrilled that he is joining us tonight with an original contribution, revisiting and proposing to partially adapt or bracket his notion of democratic individuality, given the extraordinary threats that constitutional democracy and humankind more generally faces in our days. He will explore if and how our political life is already governed by tyrannical dynamics and risks losing the very democratic culture that brought forth this special kind of democratic individuality. How, in the face of a number of complex technological, environmental, and populist, to name just but a few problems, democratic individuality, if it ever was indeed achieved, has given way to old and new forms of docility. There will be time for questions after the speech, and I warmly invite you to contribute to our discussion tonight. Please join me in welcoming Professor George Kateb.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me all right? I sometimes have a tendency to drop my voice, as I've been told many times, and you must alert me to that possibility that I am. I have two aims in this paper. The first is to make a few changes in the idea of democratic individuality and its preconditions. No surprise that the construction of the idea of democratic individuality is to some extent unstable. Foucault will figure in the revisions, but only after a few relevant aspects of his thought are first revised. The second aim, and that's what will occupy me mostly this evening, is to speculate about the fate of democratic individuality. It might be the case that no matter how this idea is revised, it might have to be given up substantially sometime in the future. At least the individualism would no longer be shaped by the lessons and practices of constitutional democracy. Truth-telling becomes the highest aspiration. There are now two identifiable crises that could account for such a fate in the not too distant future. One is the loss of constitutional democracy, and with it the loss of the culture that has sponsored and nourished democratic individuality. My contention is that we already live under incipient executive tyranny, under the beginnings of political tyranny brought on by universal state surveillance and the erosion of other rights. The establishment of full tyranny is therefore foreshadowed. The second crisis is really more than a crisis, it is an apocalypse. I mean that the confluence of global warming, the rising of the seas, unusual droughts and floods, scarcity of drinkable water, fossil fuels and other resources, and ever-expanding population might lead to such a catastrophe that the human race, if it survived, would be driven into a new kind of primitivity, where traces and memories of human advance would remain lodged, but necessarily in a disfigured form. In such a conditions, the chances are high that any thought that placed the individual at the center of moral and political life would become grossly irrelevant, or would not even appear. Individuality, as distinct from egoism or egotism, has always been precarious because it is hard to practice. But one day, it might have to surrender. Ecological ruin would likely bring forth tyranny, many tyrannies. Obviously, the second crisis is immeasurably worse than the first. Ecological ruin would affect countless people, the living and the unborn, and affect them irreversibly and in every conceivable way, adversely. Now, I do not offer myself as a prophet or predictor. If I am much more pessimistic than developments will show I had to be, then that is, of course, all to the good. But let us think the worst. The theme of this conference is docility. One form of docility especially interests me, and that is gullibility, which will have an important place in our discussion this evening. Gullibility is mental docility. It occurs when individual or cooperative mental effort of some tenacity is needed to ascertain the relevant truth, and such effort is avoided or abandoned because of trust in authority and a confirmed disposition to conform. To anticipate, the only kind of individuality I can imagine existing under some future full tyranny, if any kind can, whether that tyranny is ill or ambivalently intentioned or well-intentioned, is some version of stoic inner freedom. Inner freedom, however, cannot be a mass phenomenon, and though connected by filiation to democratic individuality, it is not the same thing. Inner freedom is a kind of bare individualism. It is one of the meditated responses to life that the theory of democratic individuality historically replaced in the favorable circumstances of secularized Protestantism. When I first stated the idea of democratic individuality in the late 1970s and early 1980s, I proposed that its great articulators, Emerson, Whitman, and Thoreau, were teaching what I called, using schematic terms not found in their work, positive individuality or self-expression, negative individuality or conscientious resistance on behalf of others, and impersonal individuality or trying hard to let the world appear before the observer as a tremendous spectacle of the unintended cooperation between numerous and equally necessary antagonistic elements. These three are the constituent parts of democratic individuality as I tried to theorize it. My judgment was and is that the theory of democratic individuality holds out the promise of elevating democratic life without wanting to restore any element of aristocratic perfectionism. Democratic individuality, when realized, aims at least to clean out some of the waste of democratic life and clear up some of the mess. It wars on incontinence, the essential democratic vice. Emerson and Whitman are the great articulators of both positive individuality and impersonal individuality, and Thoreau decisively adds the negative, although all three thinkers contribute to the enrichment of all three constituent parts. I must omit, for lack of time, a detailed discussion of the changes I propose in the theory of democratic individuality and turn first to its preconditions. So that before speaking more directly on the two crises facing constitutional democracy and their effect on individuality, I wish to suggest a revision of the political presupposition of democratic individuality, namely the theory of the social contract or agreement of the people for the creation of constitutional democracy. Before speculation about the future and the possibility that constitutional democracy will go down to tyranny, let me make a few points that political theorists, including myself, have touched on, but perhaps not have said bluntly enough. Many have not said anything at all. The points are, first, the legitimacy of any constitutional democracy is undermined by the harms it does to people beyond its borders. Such harms are inflicted mainly, but not only, in pursuit of an active and ambitious foreign policy, by war, other violence, and coercion. Ambitious foreign policy is necessarily violent, and must help to convert the social contract into a suicide pact. And third, an active and ambitious foreign policy creates emergencies that tend to change constitutional democracy into a system in which the executive authority is supreme in its concentration of powers and is continuous with, or at least points in the direction of, the establishment of full tyranny. Let me start with the individualist assumption that constitutional democracy is the only legitimate form of government. Its essence is consent, the consent of each individual to membership, which is displayed and exercised through participation in the political process, and the consent of the people as a collection of individuals, which is given to the Constitution that establishes the political system, and which, in conformity to the idea of consent, must be a system of continuous consent expressed in elections and other kinds of citizen participation. The Constitution must feature a Bill of Rights, one main purpose of which is to make consent genuine because it is not fearful, and therefore to make membership in the polity worthwhile. Now, when thinking about the legitimacy of any written constitution or agreement of the people, theorists commonly assume that we should confine ourselves to one society as if it is the whole world or exists in pristine isolation from all others, unaffected by other societies and not affecting them, as if relations with other societies do not have to be made, if not central, then more than marginal. And I think this flaw or fault besets John Rawls's theory of justice. We should not believe that as long as moral and existential values are honored in the contracted society's political system, the work of observation and critique has been done because legitimacy has been supposedly achieved. Far from closing the story on legitimacy, we can only say that we have made a good beginning. The theoretically inconvenient fact is that if the social contract arises from the basic equal right of consent and is intended by its structure and policies to protect and enlist the exercise of the other basic human rights of its citizens, it cannot consistently do so while depriving others of their human rights by violence or gross coercion beyond the borders. War against another society affects others without their consent and deeply harms them by its violence. Societies take turns initiating war or fighting back, and by doing either, they systematically violate the rights of individuals. In war, legitimate government exercises power over persons beyond the borders in the coercive and violent manner of an illegitimate government, and thus seriously diminishes its own legitimacy. War is a comprehensive denial of basic rights as any other systematic violation, and more than almost all the others. Only slavery and death camps are as comprehensively evil as war. Evil is the infliction of premature violent death and such atrocious suffering that the degradation of human beings ensues. In my judgment, the theory of the just war is a mockery of justice and often works as incitement to war because it provides an always undeserved good conscience. The theoretical concern of democratic individuality is always with the way states treat individuals, whatever their citizenship, nationality, ethnicity, or religion, and despite however much these attributes, mostly contingently acquired, matter to the people. The theorist of individual rights cares for people, but not as they care for themselves. It is necessary to say, consequently, that every social contract for the protection of basic human rights in the contracted society is only provisionally legitimate. It is not legitimate simply because it is not only usually imperfect on its own terms, but also incomplete. It can be completed only by a federation of political societies, all of them preferably with putatively legitimate governments. Only a federation that disarms states can preserve the legitimacy of any. Logically, if there is to be any legitimacy, there must be a global federation. Otherwise, all the problems of plural independent states would be transferred to plural federations. A global federation would have no foreign policy. There would be a greater chance for avoiding imperfect legitimacy if foreign policy were unnecessary. But the federation would not be a unitary world state, nor should it result from conquest. Most ordinary state functions, including police functions, would remain the work of plural states, but within the limits of global peace. Thinking about legitimacy must start from the start, reckon with the principles of nonviolence. Undeniably, the urge to break away and resume the realpolitik of plural states' original strife would remain and would need deterrence through coercion. But perfection is impossible. All I can do is point in a certain direction, and that is to the abolition of the sovereign nation state. A further point is to make war intrinsic, is that to make war intrinsic to political society in the wake of the social contract, to make war intrinsic to it, is perhaps even secretly desirable to the few. And it is to convert, as I have said, the contract of individual consent by which its government exists into a suicide pact, to use the phrase of Justice Robert Jackson. Dying to preserve a government that is supposed to preserve life is a conundrum that has never been solved. But the conundrum should be much harder to face when the government has weapons of mass destruction, as quite a few governments do. These weapons can inflict tremendous destruction of life and property beyond the borders, just as bad, but not worse. They even anticipate the adversary's retaliatory use, and hence tremendous destruction within borders. Can any idea of social contract or agreement of the people really accommodate consequences of such scope and cruelty as use of weapons of mass destruction beyond the borders of one society, and still believe that one has consented or should have consented in reason to the existence of the government that inflicts such consequences on others? Again, from the perspective of living inside the borders, can anyone be thought to have consented in reason to the contract or agreement that might result in such massive consequences inflicted in retaliation or otherwise on one's own society? Can there be a social contract that lodges such an unchecked concentration of destructive power in the initiative of one person or a few, whether elected or not? Better, as Thoreau would say, for the individual to remain unpledged, withholding consent. Ideally, arms would be no single country's possession. The last point is that the doctrine of human rights becomes worse than hypocritical when war, even defensive war, takes over the original contract and rearranges in practice the structure of the political system that the contract is supposed to create. Executive agencies become supreme. Their unilateral power becomes normal. It is fair to say that men and women in charge of an ambitious foreign policy desire a state of nature between sovereign states so that the power agon can go on, while their justifying rhetoric likens states to individuals who are exempted from morality by the claim of fearful necessity, an absurd analogy. Of course, any action meant to preserve one's life is morally permissible. But preserving the state is not morally equivalent, much less is it superior to preserving the agonistic tribal state. I see a fundamental choice, at least for the theorist. That choice is between a global federation at the cost of limiting every state's sovereignty, understood as freedom of action in foreign affairs, and allowing the steady erosion of constitutional democracy owing to the domination of executive power exercised in foreign policy, war, and Cold War, and eventually moving towards permanent emergency rule and hence tyranny. Now, the subject of The social contract and its relation to war and hence to cruel violations of basic or human rights at home and abroad, as well as to anti-constitutional executive supremacy, leads us now to the subject I referred to at the start, the two crises, the core of which is the prospect of full tyranny that both crises carry with them. However, even apart from the two crises, revision of the idea of the social contract, in my judgment, would be urgent. My discussion of the two crises is divided into three parts. Discussion of by far the most important crisis must come first, even though that crisis might come later in time than the second crisis, which I discuss in parts 2 and 3 of this paper. The first part, therefore, deals with the global ecological crisis and the desolation it could create in stages and at a different pace in various parts of the world. The rational, or at least not irrational, response to actual desolation or its likely occurrence is ecological tyranny. I then turn away from ecological tyranny and consider political tyranny in the name of national security. The second and longest part of the paper takes up at some length the present political condition of in the United States and the West, which I call incipient and nearly invisible tyranny brought about by fear of terrorism. We now are at the beginnings of the second crisis. The present response to terrorism continues to be the erosion of constitutional democracy and basic rights administered by the emergency powers of the executive authority in the name of fighting terrorism, and which is aided by legislatures and courts or proceeds in spite of them. The third and last part of my discussion builds on points made in the first two parts and can therefore be the shortest part, and is addressed to overt full tyranny imposed as a system of permanent emergency power wielded by executive authorities. Incipient tyranny is thus transforming itself into full tyranny. Let us begin with ecology and imagine that a natural catastrophe here or abroad will arise that devastates the daily life of many millions of people while temporarily leaving millions of others comparatively untouched but traumatically shaken. Perhaps the best residual individualism that could remain amid environmental ruin, actual or pending, would be beyond the capacity of the majority of people in all classes because it would consist in inner freedom. Let me say quickly that by inner freedom I mainly mean that uncommon thing, a person's freedom of mind, thinking for oneself, when everything urges to conformity. It is not impossible that a few people, sages, let us call them, could become detached from the world and see the whole situation of ruin and take the measure of all that had been lost in freedom and culture or will one day be inevitably and irretrievably lost. Truth about what was lost and the potentiality that had to remain forever unfulfilled would be confined to these sages, while the common disseminated impression of the past would be fictional. But the sages do not disclose the truth to other sages or other people. For them, there would be no point in questioning the methods used by tyrannies to cope with ecological ruin, no point in mourning or nostalgia. Yet I impute to sages the conviction that the human race amidst its degeneration was not all it could be or all that it once was, that the human race was infinite potentiality, infinite creativity, but requiring lucky prompts it had always received but could not again receive. There would have to be a passion for the truth despite the frustration of having to keep quiet and passion for little else. When inner freedom is the only possible individuality, it is especially called for when resistance is no longer possible or desirable or is likely to be futile. What then should drive truth for the sake of truth in the circumstances of ecological tyranny? The purpose cannot be instrumental. The impulse behind seeking truth for its own sake is rather to preserve the stature of the human species in such dire circumstances by concern for the honor of the human species. In such circumstances, human stature is distilled into honor, while its once highest expression, the pursuit of great and memorable achievements, must be allowed to lapse, a feeling for honor that is rooted in remembrance of the unique human capacity both to transcend animal needs and to refuse to sink even lower than animals by perversity, one's personal honor becomes impersonal. One becomes a representative of the human species rather than a particular person with a proud investment in one's reputation in one's own eyes. One becomes the truth teller, the sage, silent, becomes a representative of the species that is uniquely capable of knowing truth, even with no collaborators or witnesses. A person here and there among the few who adhere to the truth could say, I have kept my mind free of superstitious myths about the past and present that are bound to flourish amidst worsening ecological conditions or actual ecological ruin and primitivity. When truth is pursued for its own sake, a person is permitted to say, I am one of those who are not deceived. Enough of ecological speculation. I wish to emphasize that what I've said about individuality and truth-telling under ecological tyranny applies with a few changes to individuality and truth-telling under full overt political tyranny, which I'll come to at the end. The most important change is the conceptual possibility of heroic resistance under political tyranny. As I have said, I will at the end of the paper return briefly to full overt tyranny. But first I wish to take up our present condition, incipient tyranny, which raises a few theoretical questions that I want to explore, especially the role of truth-telling in it, under it. So let us turn now to our condition, and thus to the fate of individuality under the beginnings of tyranny, an ambivalently intentioned incipient tyranny, accepted or imposed by a government in the name of security, with fear of terrorism at the heart of it, but with accommodation for all sorts of motives and interests that lend it support. I begin with the judgment that we in the U.S. live under an incipient tyranny, now largely invisible and impalpable to the large majority, who live almost as if this tyranny did not exist. Other constitutional democracies do likewise, perhaps France even worse. To repeat, the essence is universal surveillance and the erosion of basic rights, although universal surveillance by itself is enough to stamp a government as incipiently tyrannical. Indeed, by some standards of dignity, what is incipient is actually present. It is fully tyrannical. Most of us have so far not been aware that such surveillance has been directed at us. But which of us knows for sure? What matters is the mere existence of such a capacity as universal surveillance of telephone and computer and other personal communications and documents, and the buildup of knowledge of a person's comings and goings and habits, political involvements, tastes, and interests. There should be something disgusting about being known too well. Then, too, awareness of universal surveillance has already had some practical chilling effect, but it is easy and more common to lead one's life without giving it a thought. Nonetheless, the government can know whatever it wants about us, except in the utmost privacy and seclusion and in electronic disconnection. For the time being, the truth seeker would be preoccupied by the question as to how the United States and other Western powers have come to be in a situation of permanently endangered national security with shocking moments of actual death and destruction. Universal surveillance is claimed to be indispensable to preventing and resisting permanent dangers to national security. With the capacity developed, not much has been needed to justify its use because of shocking terrorist events. Some of the governments in Muslim countries and many Muslim people in Muslim countries and outside them are hostile to the United States and the West. It is obvious that terrorist or jihadist attacks beyond borders come mostly from Muslims. How did such animosity become so inflamed? Of course, the terrorists do not call themselves or think of themselves as terrorists, just as Americans do not think of themselves as imperialists. The question of causes of animosity directed at the U.S. and the West is not asked often enough, as if once there is terror, its very nature is to appear unprovoked. There must be a response, and only foolish, perhaps masochistic people worry about whether it is possible that the U.S. and the West might have actually provoked or helped to excite attacks on themselves. However, one answer, not, of course, totally unfamiliar in the U.S. and the West, is that the U.S. is an imperialist country and leads a coalition that cooperates with U.S. imperialism. Is it possible, then, that U.S. imperialism is the decisive cause of Muslim animosity and hence Muslim terrorism? Imperialism heaps up grievances. Just look at the latest events in Yemen, for example, both moral and existential in its targeted populations. To be sure, U.S. imperialism is not colonial in the immemorial sense. Rather, it is a matter of exerting influence in the domestic affairs of numerous countries through such devices as hundreds of bases, coups that have been engineered, aided, encouraged, or tacitly approved, dangerous plans and policies that aim at regime change by war if necessary, cyber war, economic sanctions, cynical or self-deceived humanitarian intervention, and bribery. The most blatant course of action is naturally the initiation of aggressive war. Just yesterday, the U.S. invaded Iraq and Afghanistan using the most advanced military technology in search of non-existent weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, and invaded Afghanistan in search of the initiators of the destruction of the Twin Towers. The effects of these methods has built up an incalculable accumulation of grievance and the desire for revenge when strict retaliation in the form of counter-invasion of the U.S. is impossible. Now, as long as there are freedom of speech, speech that is free from systematic government intimidation or persecution, and other elements, though weakened, of constitutional democracy, I think that truth-telling, which is determined resistance on behalf of the whole society and beyond, and hence is a negative mode of democratic individuality, would be the central and most weighty manifestation of democratic individuality, even though positive individuality, self-expression, would remain the most commonly favored component under what is still an invisible and impalpable tyranny. Intellectual resistance is suitably the work of a minority, yet even though the truth-telling negative individuality is for the sake of resistance on behalf of the whole society, the society is largely unpersuadable, and not only because large segments of it are inattentive. The majority is captured by a myth of the supreme goodness of American conduct in the world. All the freedom of speech that a society can give will do little to dispel myth with such a tenacious hold. We know the myth. The U.S. does only good in the world and does a great deal of it and does it in an altruistic spirit. Obama's Nobel acceptance speech is a perfect expression of this myth. Its enemies act out of envy, selfishness, corruption, and barbaric superstition. The U.S. intervenes only where it feels threatened in its rightful purposes, or where peoples in foreign countries look to its rescue to rescue them from oppression. The errors of the U.S. are minor in comparison to the evils it destroys and the valuable contributions that it makes to human well-being. In any case, the U.S. has a perfect right to make the world safer for its freedom and the freedom of others. These, then, are some main themes in the myth. The people's acceptance of the myth of the solely benign and largely altruistic role and policy of the U.S. or the whole West in the world makes the myth nearly immune to criticism. Why then persist in truth-telling when it is futile? This is the same question I ask when discussing ecological tyranny. In a minute, I'll answer it in roughly the same way by reference, though not exclusively to human dignity, but with some changes. To be sure, the invisible tyranny does not seem to make it dangerous for public truth-tellers and thus preserves free speech. But toleration by itself does not necessarily elicit searching criticism that makes an impact on public opinion. The main point is that at just about any time we can normally expect the passion for truth on the transcendent political issue of society to be the affair of only a minority, as slavery was the affair in the North of only a minority, and that minority viciously hounded, persecuted, the abolitionists, I mean. Another point is that truth-telling under the aegis of democratic individuality has not been and should not be associated with training people to lead perfected good lives or fit them to govern others well. That is with care of the self, and there are passages in the paper that try to enter a critique of the very idea, Foucauldian idea, of care of the self as thoroughly aristocratic and untenable for us. From a heightened awareness of the destruction the U.S. has wrought and the dire consequences at home comes moral revulsion. But another kind of revulsion can also arise in our period. This other revulsion is defined by the belief that the dreadful consequences for other countries and the U.S. have been sustained, not only by the encompassing myth of American goodness in its conduct of foreign affairs, but also in the recent case of American policy, especially in the Middle East, by deliberate lies to an extent that perhaps has never been exceeded when the stakes were so high. Among the truth seekers, there has been thus not only moral revulsion at the great harms inflicted on populations, but also revulsion at the untruth that sustained and sustains U.S. foreign policy. And this second revulsion was and remains intensified by the specific lies in the case of Iraq. Lies, of course, existed before the invasion of Iraq and continue always, but the lies about Iraq were the most blatant that I know of in American history. This revulsion, one of the spurs to wanting to know the truth. How did my revulsion come about? Why has it come to such extremes? This revulsion lies, I would categorize as a disgusted response to an insulting assault on the dignity of citizens. In our condition, an invisible tyranny, albeit with freedom of speech, truth-telling, when it is largely futile and likely to remain so, is also a matter of the species' dignity, which I have said is a distillation of the idea of human stature into devotion to the species' honor. I mean that one wants the truth to be recorded so that other people in the future, if only a few, who can say how many, will know that numbers of people lived in our period who were not deceived about the reasons for the emergence of ill-intentioned or ambivalently intentioned invisible tyranny and the role it played in its subsequent transformation into overt tyranny. It is a matter of the honor of humanity, human stature, that there often is and always should be some who hold truth in such esteem that they can be said to want truth for the sake of truth. They want undeceived people to exist, and they want truth not for or not only for pragmatic or instrumental reasons, and they needn't be heroes or martyrs. At last, and I'm very near the end now, we come to the question, what of truth-telling under full political tyranny? There are two choices. If you live under a full political tyranny, something that has not yet happened to the United States, but may very well happen. Two choices. The first is to cultivate inner freedom, similar to truth-telling under ecological tyranny, but not exactly the same. Remember, we're now talking about full tyranny. One is a truth seeker, pursuing the truth but not speaking it except to oneself. As under ecological tyranny, one wants to know the truth about one's society. In the case of political tyranny, how tyranny came to be and what the tyrant's techniques and methods are. One's honor as a representative of the human species would be the spur, the will not to be deceived. The other choice is to reject inner freedom as pusillanimous and choose to be a truth teller to others, whatever the risk or even the certainty of great loss to oneself. In short, to be a moral hero, a supererogatory figure who goes beyond what is morally required, but is only morally optional. The truth teller under full tyranny is a kind of individualist, not too remote from negative democratic individuality, but with a determination and bravery that only heroism or martyrdom can achieve. involved is a conception of truth for truth's sake as part of resistance against tyranny on behalf of others. This is the resistance that grows out of moral revulsion and revulsion at the assault on the dignity of the subject. Is some kind of honor involved in heroic truth-telling, whether personal honor or devotion to the honor of humanity? Is that the ultimate motive of truth for the sake of truth under full political tyranny, including the tyranny of the majority? Yes. Yes. Honor matters most when truth-telling is assumed to be both dangerous and almost certainly futile. Under full tyranny, that assumption would be reasonable. The important point we should emphasize is that the truth-teller, under such circumstances, represents the human species and does not speak just for himself or herself and their conscience. He speaks for the honor of all. That means that the truth-teller is not a martyr for a system of belief whose foundation is some special learning, insight, or faith for which the martyr stakes everything. Such martyrdom cannot represent humanity. Only risk for truth in the most elementary sense, factual truth and truthful interpretation, could possibly do so. We associate this conception of devoting one's life to truth-telling under tyranny, as always, first with Socrates in Plato's The Apology of Socrates, and to some extent, thanks to Foucault, also with Diogenes the Cynic in the collection of his utterances in Diogenes Laertius in Volume 2 of Lives of the Eminent Philosophers. Both Socrates and Diogenes took great risks, and Socrates anyway was willing to be a public truth-teller, even if it meant death or some other terrible penalty like banishment, which for Socrates was worse than death. Foucault's meditation on Socrates and Diogenes dominates his last book, the lectures he gave at the Collège de France in February, March 1984, shortly before his death in June of that year. This book, The Courage of Truth, is perhaps his greatest altogether, and he produced it in sickness in the shadow of death. It is heartless but true to say that this is a work in late style at its most sublime, the style of one who knows that he or she is near the end of life, but knows that there is still something that must be said. I think that the power and sterling beauty of Foucault's meditation will, however, survive his misjudged aesthetic turn to the idea of care of the self in discussing both Socrates and Diogenes, as if such care were their primary motive, and obviously it is not. Furthermore, Foucault's late work deserves to be, despite its concentration on dangerous heroic speech, one of the indispensable contributions to truth-telling about the transcendent political issue in society in any given time, even when, as in our condition, heroism is not needed because freedom of speech still exists. Foucault's meditation can inspire the will to truth in any condition, reinforced by his work, Fearless Speech, seminars at Berkeley in the fall of 1983. Risks that Socrates and perhaps Diogenes faced have not so far appeared, at least in the U.S. One speaks without fear, despite some mild anxiety that one's government will find ways to persecute the truth-teller. One's negative democratic individuality can continue to exemplify its nature in an unheroic but not entirely risk-free form of resistance on behalf of others, fortified by a sense of the dignity of the human species. Although one can frighten oneself by hearing or reading one's own outspokenness, one can try to stay unperturbed by fear of persecution at the present time. The person who aims to be a truth teller on the transcendent political issue must still face the beginnings of political tyranny, whatever its intentions, and the prospect of full and overt political tyranny, whatever intentions we impute to it, and not keep quiet and show in one mode of expression or another that the truth-telling individual these days should be haunted. That's it.
Thank you immensely for that marvelous, although somewhat depressing, always. Or an another philosopher. Train oneself, yes, one follows. What does one follow? Train oneself. Rules laid down by others, as in his treatment of Seneca's letters to Lucilius. I don't think one can be trained to be a truth teller. There must be revulsion, but God knows, and only God knows, which is to say, it's not knowable, how one feels the revulsions that often are the spur to wanting to tell the truth. I don't think I made it clear enough at least in the excerpts that I read. There must be revulsion. And then something overtakes the person. Something overtakes the person. It's impossible to say what it is that overtakes the person. But my sense of the dignity of the human race, eventually, not initially, is what spurs me. Having needed the initial spur of moral and dignity revulsion, spurs me into action to know the truth, even if I don't tell it, because it wouldn't do any good. But it does good. It does good to my sense of what the human race is. I don't think you can be trained. I don't think you can, no matter how much you care for yourself, you can ever end up in such a situation. Care of yourself, I continue to think, is, if not narcissistic, it does lead easily to dandyism, Foucault himself said so, although he thought it a misdirection. I want to stay with the notion of democratic individuality. I do not want care of self to compete with it, because in my judgment it will lose or mislead impressionable others. Democratic individuality does its work. The institutions of democracy do their work, again, visibly, silently, by osmosis. People just become that way because they live in a society where certain things happen in certain ways and not in other ways. Before you know it, a genius comes along, Emerson, another, Thoreau, another, Whitman, perhaps Margaret Fuller. How have we been living? Not well. Do I see something other than ill-living? And they all answered yes. There are intimations of something better than the way people ordinarily live. These people who ordinarily live poorly know it, and they betray themselves here and there by gestures of generosity or understanding or sympathy. This must be accentuated. Can it be cultivated? No, I don't think so, except by osmosis. You just keep living in a democratic society, which is a constitutional democracy, not a majoritarian democracy, and very good things happen. That's what Emerson, perhaps, was the first genius to say. And he taught the lesson to Thoreau and Whitman and others. So not care of itself. It's not a democratic idea. And not even Cavell's perfectionism is a democratic idea. It's an aristocratic idea. Be the best that you can be. No, Emerson says, be what you are. Be what you are, pay your debts. I still think that Foucault, it's stupid to say so. I think Foucault would have benefited from reading Emerson Thoreau. There's no evidence that he read anything, is there? Not even in Berkeley. Is there any evidence? There is no evidence, but there might be. How's that for a good answer? Now, concerning politics and truth telling, I have a confession to make. That confession is, for a while, and even recently, most recently, Trump was saying things about American foreign policy that I haven't heard from any political leader in this country. I think he was great, even though he is a clown and a terrible man. And I hope he loses. But I certainly don't want Hillary Clinton to win. So where am I? She's probably the lesser evil. Is she good in herself? No. Trump is a terrible, terrible man who, whose motivations for telling the truth about Iraq and Syria and Libya and Yemen and Palestine, I don't know. Where did that come from? He certainly wasn't trained at the military academy. He claims to have gone to tell the truth there, but he wasn't trained there to tell the truth. But you see, again, it's kind of Emersonian, isn't it? When all of a sudden, somebody you don't expect to do a good thing does a good thing. Pops up because of a general encouragement in the atmosphere to say things that are on your mind and so on. I'm just now filibustering. I don't know what else to say. Okay? Not okay.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask you about surveillance as a way of producing docility. You mentioned that, you know, a lot of people don't know the extent to which they're being washed. It strikes me when talking to my students about surveillance that they know quite well the extent to which they're being washed and don't care. They don't care, right? So it's often said that we live in a confessional culture, right? Social media has made us all minor celebrities, yeah. And spill our guts to people we only know distantly. It just seems we're accustomed to getting ads micro-targeted, right? So that the...
Yes. Yes.
It's clear that to the extent we're intimidated by surveillance, right? There's a very obvious way in which that compromises individuality and renders us docile. But what would you say about... you might say, look, these students are being naive, of course this information could be used. So there's incipient here, it could be used to intimidate. But let's leave that aside and ask about this kind of defiance in the face of surveillance, or at least not caring about it. What are the implications of those kinds of attitudes for what you're calling democratic individuality?
Right. Some years ago I wrote a paper called on being washed and known. And I made it clear then, and I still think it's the case. I think Bernard was written a whole book on it called Exposure, on voluntary and involuntary aspects of it. I think people are oddly, it's strange, two things are going on simultaneously. They should cancel each other out, instead they intensify each other. They are wanting to expose themselves and feeling ever more vulnerable, touching and things. I don't get it, right? I've been taught undergraduates that they will tell you, if not intentional, they will answer your question for you. I can't answer your question for you. So I'd say I agree with what you say. People seem to welcome surveillance. They want to be watched and known. And then they cry a lot when their feelings are hurt. But they don't seem to worry about the indignity of not having a secret, or the indignity of not really being private, or the indignity of wanting to tell everything about oneself. They damage their own dignity. And however, would you say that the population of the United States would be docile? If there were blatant cases of government interference with ideas that they could have knowledge of only through surveillance, do you think suddenly there was a story? Well, there have been many stories. We've spied on this and spied on that. I don't know. Look, I think I've not really given you the answer you deserve. What would you say, then? What would you say in answer to your own question? You teach me. It is the passion to be known, cooperating excessively with the practice of universal surveillance. Is it cooperating with it and bringing onto itself something worse than it would get if it were not for this welcome? Is it? Does the government feel freer to keep people under surveillance because of things like Facebook?
I'd say probably so.
Probably so. Good. Then you have answered the question.
Thank you so much for your wonderful talk. I also actually wanted to mention very briefly, I was just in Cambridge for a year.
Cambridge Banks.
Yeah, I'm in the UK.
The real
What I found interesting is I spent time there and I spent time here in Colombia among Muslim students.
Yes.
And it's very interesting that there, things aren't very politically active, but I saw very real ways in which prevent was directly influencing what Muslim students would do on campus and the events that the speakers were there. Versus here, when the NYP released their AP released their report saying that NYP was spying on Muslim students on college campuses, I really sensed a great anxiety here on campus among the students.
Which you did not notice in UK.
Not in Cambridge specifically. I just think that was just an interesting observation in terms of anxiety and surveillance and sort of binocular.
Are Muslims in Colombia docile than they otherwise would be?
I find that they're, in some ways, perhaps very hyper-aware.
Hyper-aware that they might suffer for their outspokenness, is that right?
Yes. For example, there was an informant several years ago at Teachers College that spoke. And he came out about him being an informant the summer after he spoke. And there was a lot of anxiety among the Muslim students people would even suspect that other people were informants.
Yeah.
It was very, very scary, and that was something that I didn't see at Cambridge, but still I felt the political effect at Cambridge, even though there wasn't, there was a docility about it. But my question was not about that was just the factual. I wanted to ask about, related to Professor Hartford's comments about truth-telling, and what exactly do you mean by that? And I'm thinking particularly in the context that you drew between American imperialism and Muslim terrorists, and I'm curious about those categories. Because I felt to some degree, I felt a bit of a Huntingtonian clash of civilizations there, and I agree that the West is not some mere Hegelian myth, as Talal Asad wrote. But there is some sense in which, how do we talk about ideology but also political constructions? And I'm reminded of Roxanne Newton's work on epiphenomena, and how, you know, she doesn't want to put political constructions aside, but in some way, we do have to talk about ideology,
yes.
But what's interesting in her book is that she, her book Anomie in the Mirror, is that she refers to both sort of the works of Said Qutb, who's looking after some essential notion of justice and truth.
Yes.
Who's also the root of a lot of radical terrorists, and also the similarities of Western scholarship, like Maginder and Arendt. So I'm just interested, to some degree it seems that these categories break down, and I'm reminded a little bit of Foucault's idea of heterotopia. But I'm just interested in how you reconcile this notion of truth-telling, which sort of clashes in some ways with these categories and the ways that actors in these categories express themselves and act politically.
I'm not yet clear as to how
sure.
What the clash is between advocating truth-telling in the sense that I hastily define as factual truth, together with truthful interpretation, which I know is a question begging way of putting it. But I would try to expand what I mean by that, if I can. I continue to believe that truth, factual truth, is possible and matters, and I continue to believe that though there can be a range of interpretations of any given phenomenon, there are rather strict limits on that range. Otherwise, the interpretation becomes far-fetched. So, it is, I hope, not far-fetched to say that a myth sustains American foreign policy, a myth about altruistic United States of America, and it sustains the foreign policy of Britain and France as well, in some respects worse. And let us dispel the myth, and I think I am being proper when I say there are myths and there are truths. And the point is to dispel myths, if possible, in the light of truth. Now, if you want me to tell you, I will. There is a passage here condemning Foucault's early hostility to the very idea of truth and making it simply a disciplinary artifact, driven by the will to power, with no sense that some statements are true and others not true. His first Collège de France course of lectures. Now I'm telling Bernard what he told me, so to speak. on the will to knowledge, the first culture of 1997, that's all about, and I have this in the paper, Nietzsche's pretty awful essay on truth and lies in an extra moral sense. Foucault devotes his entire course of lectures to that one adolescent prank, and it left him scarred. Truth is only the will to power, and I don't believe that for a moment, and perhaps I don't think Nietzsche did either. Let me hazard while I'm being irresponsible, let me persist in my folly. I think Foucault is one of the few writers on whom Nietzsche had a bad influence, and on whom Heidegger had a good influence. It is Nietzsche that damages Foucault, and then slowly, in the last 3, 4, 5 years of his life, he grows out of his superstitious allergy to truth, this insistence that it is motivated by the will to power, the will to domination, nothing else, as if there were no truth in the world. But why is he writing these books if he didn't believe in saying the truth? I know he said, these are my fictions, but that everybody says that. This paper is my fiction. Everybody says that. That's just belonging to prefer more to help. So I will persist in my belief that the word truth has a non-ideological. Do you disagree with that?
I'm not sure. I'm reminded of Foucault, the last line of The Order of Things, and the face dissolving in the sand, which reminds me greatly of Heidegger's fear of technological conditions and alienation, which is also in Venice. And to me, there's some sense in which, and John Wilson makes an argument like, he made an argument like that at King's College 50th anniversary of Order of Things. I don't know, to me, there's some sense in what does it mean to articulate truth? And to me, at least, it seems there's some way in which truth isn't quite, some fundamental idea of truth isn't articulable. To me, that's what that signals.
But I think we must agree to disagree.
Professor Hershman? George, great lecture as always. Where are the corporations? Where's the world of capital? And then as you're articulating all the horrors that war has produced and all the travesties that government is now exercising over its citizens, corporations surveil us.
Of course.
They provide a blueprint for the NSA. They have wrought as much environmental and personal damage to individual societies as any war has. So where does global capital fit into your...
I don't accept your last sentence. I don't know that... maybe United Fruit imposed more damage on Guatemala than anybody's army. That's probably true. But think of Nicaragua and El Salvador, where hundreds of thousands of people in El Salvador die of all. That I keep saying is that it's true. I have a passage in this paper about the way in which dispelling the myth might involve some references, it must involve some references to the economic structure of the United States. As long as you do not take the Leninist belief that imperialism is the last stage of capitalism. I think imperialism is better understood by C. Wright Mills than it ever was by any Marxist or Leninist. And that is that though corporate power is immense and the corporate capacity to inflict harm is great, the fact must remain that there are other motivations in play when the United States embarks on its imperialist foreign policy. There is power, the power elite. The power elite is not solely, as Mills has phrased, it's not solely capitalist. I mean, the military intelligence complex now has its own interest, and it's, as I call it, in the fifth semi-autonomous. I do believe in the existence of a deep state in the United States. And I also believe in the existence concurrently of a private public state in the United States. And I believe, of course, still in the formal public state. What is the deep state? It is military intelligence forces. What is the private public state? It's lobbyists and various political officials. These two, the deep state and the private public state, compete with the official formal public state for supremacy. So there's a struggle for between the three of them. They are not solely the servants of capital. That was a long-winded way on my part of making that point. You must introduce the role of capitalism in encouraging American expansion and advance and exploitation of others. But by now, I think it is the U.S. state, the deep state, and the private public state, and the formal official state that have developed a mindset of being a great power, being the only superpower. And the reason is not solely economic. Lenin cannot provide the best way into this. What would you say? You think he does?
No, I'm not a Lenin. Okay. As you know.
Okay. But you're accusing me of being hostile to economic
concerns. No, I'm really wondering where it plays a role in, because of course, themselves are often motivated by economic interests, right?
Think
of the first Iraq war. It's about jobs. It's about oil. It's about, there were all sorts of economic justifications, right? And that's always part of this.
Economic justifications can be used by political power forces. If the corporations seem to be getting their way, it's because some of the government want them to get their way for reasons that they do not have the prosperity of the corporation in mind. There is such a thing as what the Corinthians said about the Athenians, the first Congress of Sparta. They said, and the Corinthians were addressing the Spartans. The Corinthians said of the Athenians, they take no rest themselves and give none to others. Was it just economic depredation that lay behind what the Corinthians said about Athens? No. They knew that some demon had been released to make the Athenians crazy to be in motion, crazy to show how we can make things happen, and crazy to show that they could prevail in any contest. I do believe that's part of the mentality of the American power elite. You know, it's even part of the mentality of corporation leaders. It's not solely to personal enrichment. It is an add-on. As long as you have an add-on, and you will currently have a great power that is agonistic. I think, yes, you must take into account economic interests, but make them servants to the add-on. Willing servants, but servants nevertheless. That's my answer. Okay.
Yeah, that's about it, Jan. But I'd like to go back to the truth.
Yes.
Because there is a heros side of the truth. Truth has a kind of desire to be, or the heroic desire to be. And this, for me, is what is very worrying when we transport it into politics. Because it is a symmetry for truth that can be even more dangerous than the factual truth itself. So it's not the case that since we cannot divest ourselves of these passions, because truth comes always with passions,
Otherwise, we would be in the heaven without any passions and emotions. And Drew is clearly clear. It's totally, for us, impossible even to understand. So the only tool we have is full of desire for truth and full of chaos in this sense. Now, if this is the case, perhaps the best thing we can do in order to protect ourselves from this desire for truth is to look for mistakes. That is, to look for the negative, to look for this grain of truth inside of the many wrong. I don't feel that wrong is so problematic in this case. And perhaps it's the critical aspect that is much more important than the desire for truth. So it's like to be more of seeing what, being like mosquitoes instead of being like a beautiful papillon. And pick it instead of declaring the truth. And see all the time inside of even the wrong that there is a grain of truth. I don't believe in this white and black description somehow. And this is perhaps our salvation or our possibility to emerge from this very gloomy picture that you gave us, because there is no way out otherwise.
Well, you know, there might not be a way out of either political tyranny or ideological. There might not be a way out, but then again, there might be. I really don't see what hope there is ecologically. I think it's just going to be awful. And I'm old enough to be able to say to myself, I don't expect to live to see it, to think it. But I'm full of gloom about what would happen to civilization. Human life by these ecological tendencies. That's one thing to say. I would not want to think that you must revise your idea of truth in order to avoid gloom. There must be another motive. I think I got wind of that other motive when you took, it once again showed how close to J.S. Mill your thinking is. In every doctrine, there is some truth and some falsehood. In any period, the truth of a doctrine becomes false, and the thought, imputed falsehood in a doctrine becomes truth. What then is truth? What is Mill's final answer as to what truth is? I'm afraid his final answer is there is no truth, and I refuse to take that position. I just will not take that position. Does that mean that I want to close my ears? No, I opened them wide when Trump started going about Iraq, the mistake of Iraq. He keeps doing it. I will agree with you to this extent. I don't know where the truth will ever come from. It comes, the wind blows where it lists. Quote. Testament on the Holy Spirit. It flows and say it goes where it wants. Truth emerges where it does, where it can. You never know from whom you will learn truth. But that commits me to believing that it is the truth that may emerge unexpectedly and not have this as a.
Great, yes, thanks. So actually I wanted to revisit a couple of issues in Alex's question and the question about the capital. I think one of the interesting things about surveillance today is people who are watching are not just government. I wonder whether that has something to do with sort of students and, you know, general citizens not being very concerned about it, because they know that Facebook is watching and they know that online advertisers are watching. They don't really worry about the government watching. And I wonder whether part of that, and here's a little connection with a separate issue, and you're bringing up executive tyranny in the United States. You know, when I look at the United States, I don't see executive tyranny, I see gridlock and a government that can't do anything.
On one level, yes.
Right, so.
Not the deep state.
Sure,
okay.
Yeah. So, you know, that being said, I think it's a little, It's hard to imagine the conventional state, right, actually doing much with its power. The deep state is interested in war and those types of things, but it's not really interested in meddling with our daily lives, it seems.
No, not yet. It has the capacity to do so anytime it wants. That's the thing that worries me. No, not yet. I live my life. I'm aware of what is possible. I am haunted. But it's not a full tyranny. But it has for years wanted the capacity it now has. You remember Poindexter? Was Reagan president? Admiral Poindexter Reagan, when Reagan was president? This goes back to the mid-80s. This wish to have complete knowledge of a whole society. Here Foucault is a great factor because he does worry about surveillance. He really does. There's this poignant moment in one of his earlier books, maybe on the Abnormal, where he looks with envy on certain people whose names were not known by anyone else but the people immediately around. That is part of his, perhaps his nostalgia for not the primitive, but the simple, but the simplified. Yes. Go ahead.
It seems like students of bureaucracy in the United States will say that it's not just the Congress that can't get things done, but the imagined capacity of intelligence agencies is actually not that great. They don't know what to do. They're collecting lots of data. They don't know how to analyze it. They don't really know what to do with it. Because it's a big bureaucracy that actually just doesn't work very well.
It sometimes fails. You have to wonder whether they want to fail.
Whether they want to fail?
Yeah. It's also the case that there is an acquisitiveness of information that is valuable to some of them without any reference to its utility. But others know, well, look, they're doing all this for whatever reason they're doing it, accumulating all this stuff. Who knows? One day we might find it something useful. Was George W. Bush or not? Was Cheney pleased that 9/11 happened? I think the answer is yes. Certainly people around him, the neocons, were pleased. You read Richard Perle's letter to Netanyahu, it's in 1987. The U.S. must become a more militarized society, and these are the things we're going to do when we become more militarized. There's the plan. You dismember Iraq and eliminate the leadership in Syria and militarize society. And what am I saying? It's perhaps that some in the government knew 9/11 was about to happen and didn't try to plan. It's not impossible. I'm not saying that that is actually. It's within the realm of possibility. I'd like to talk to Mr. Snowden. He would know.
Thank you so much.